I was getting picked on just because I couldn't read. They treated me like lesser of a person.
I feel that I'm like a regular person. My family always tells me that. I'm a regular person.
I got called retarded basically every day and went home crying a lot. They made me feel like the tiniest person in the world.
All of us have moments when our lives are changed forever. And for millions of people over the last half century, those moments started with a woman who insisted to the world that they're just like anyone else. Her name was Eunice Kennedy Shriver. She came from a famous family with a brother who would one day become president of the United States. She also had an older sister named Rosemary, who was born with an intellectual disability.
Rosemary was born at a time when people with intellectual disabilities were routinely institutionalized.
You gotta contextualize it. People with developmental differences are forgotten, they're isolated.
But growing up as a Kennedy, Rosemary was deeply loved, and she was never forgotten by Eunice.
The relationship between my mother and Rosemary was the closest. In that experience of growing up, loving and caring about someone deeply, what she felt was the capacity to make a difference. When her brother was elected president of the United States, my mother saw her opening. It was an opening to change the country, so she charged.
In a family of achievers and athletes, Eunice had been competing her whole life. Standing up for people with intellectual disabilities was simply a new challenge, and one she'd attack by turning to a familiar place, the sports field.
She saw that through sports, you can change the world. If you put kids with developmental differences in with able-bodied kids, and they compete at the same level, or compete just as valiantly, so just as bravely, all that misunderstanding, all those prejudices, all that crap is gonna go out the window.
Her philosophy was that they were as good at sports as anybody else. And when people said that's not true, she said, you know, I'll prove it.
The chance to prove it came when a mother reached out to her in 1962, frustrated that she couldn't find any summer activities for her child with a disability. Eunice decided to fill the void in her Maryland backyard. She called it Camp Shriver.
Every summer, there were 100 volunteers who would come to our house every day. And then there were 100 people with intellectual disabilities who would come every morning. And that was on a quiet day. It had horseback riding, it had archery, it had obstacle courses.
Playing in the backyard, swimming in a pool, and they're always part of the family.
As Camp Shriver grew and flourished, Eunice began dreaming of something on a much bigger scale, something more significant, more competitive, with more athletes. And in 1968, at a sparsely filled stadium in Chicago, Eunice inaugurated the first Special Olympics.
In ancient Rome, the gladiators went into the arena with these words on their lips: "Let me win. But if I cannot win, let me be brave the attempt."
There was enormous fear going into Chicago. Would they be able to compete? Would they understand? But all the people who came left knowing they had seen something that would forever change their lives. A person given the chance to show, allowed to prove that they're great. This is what sports did in Chicago in 1968.
The 1968 Special Olympics were an inspiring first step. But Eunice's movement still faced tremendous challenges. Resources and support were scarce, and she was criticized, even mocked, for taking up a cause so few others believed in. But Eunice forged ahead, determined to realize her dream.
In the 60s in America, there's not a lot of roles for women at that point. And a woman with that much energy and that much power, you know, you get out of the way because she's coming.
She would see a no as a challenge to destroy the opposition.
She was so relentless in what she wanted. And what she wanted was for everybody to be accepted, to be included.
And that's what drives the whole movement forward.
As the movement caught on around the world, for Eunice, the challenge remained the same as when it was just about Rosemary, to inspire and empower people who for too long had been treated like they were invisible.
You're told, you know, he has Down syndrome, and you're given a book that tells you everything bad that can happen. Everything is a negative. There's no positive at all.
I didn't ever talk to nobody. The age of 1 to probably 12. Because I think somebody was make fun of me, so I stayed to myself.
Kind of in the middle of sixth grade, I got shoved in the locker pretty much every day.
Get up, get out, get away from these flyers, cause they don't get your soul or your fire. Take my hand, not your fingers through mine, and we'll walk from this dark room for the last time.
Then and now, the Special Olympics have provided generations of athletes a community where they can compete and thrive.
Special Olympics is my life.
890 medals, and they are all gold.
I want you to kick to the middle, drill to the end going down, drill to the middle, sink to the end on the way back.
Okay. It's what gave him his confidence, his ability to stand tall. Thank God for Special Olympics. How else would he got there?
Playing sports, you have to speak to somebody. Special Olympics gave me the courage, started getting outside my shell and start talking to people.
It taught me that I can be good at something. My board and me are one. I don't have a disability when I'm on my board. I feel free. It's the best feeling in the world.
Tell me that you'll open your eyes. Tell me that you'll
I had a letter from the kids from back home. He said, "You my hero. I had never been called a hero. It made me feel like I did something good in my life."
Tell me that you open your eyes.
Eunice Kennedy Shriver, the always proud sister of Rosemary, passed away in 2009. But through the Special Olympics, she transformed the lives of millions of athletes and made the world a more inclusive and inspiring place for us all.
It's welcome, acceptance, love. All of this is part of what built our country. And you can't do it if you don't accept everybody.
Tell me.